jumping off the porch like mom's not home. Tell me why the best things feel so wrong. Summer nights, love them how they take so long.
What's up guys, it's Josh and we are back again with another video. As you guys know, I have been studying abroad in Paris for the past 4 weeks and I have been getting a lot of comments about somebody else who's been here also. So, you guys have been asking about it for a long time. I would like to introduce my buddy from Princeton University, Nic Chae.
What's happening guys, my name's Nick, and today we're coming back at y'all with a video talking about life at Yale and Princeton. We thought it'd be a great idea to give you guys some perspective on what our different lives are like. So let's just jump into it.
Let's get into it.
All right, so we're gonna be doing a part one, part two series on both of our channels. So make sure you guys go check out the link down below to see the other side of the video. We actually just met like 10 minutes ago, so we haven't learned anything about each other, but I think it'd be great to start off with, you know, academics.
Yeah, let's do it.
So at Princeton, we do it based on courses. I don't know, is that the case for Yale?
Yeah.
Okay, so my freshman schedule, I was taking 4 classes in the fall and the spring, but I am an AB major compared to Josh, who is BSc, meaning that he's gonna have a little bit more of a heavier workload. Do you wanna talk about that?
Yes, so over at Yale, I am studying electrical engineering and computer science. Yale, the way the courses work is you need 36 courses to graduate, and they're actually divided into 3 different sets of 12. So you have 12 that are required for your major, which is kind of an average number. Most majors require 12, mine happens to require like 18. Then you have 12 for your distributional requirements, which are the courses that you have to take in each specific discipline, like quantitative reasoning or social sciences, stuff like that. And then your last 12 are left for you to explore.
That's actually really interesting because we also have the same thing called distributional requirements, like QR, quantitative reasoning, scientific, you know, some STLs and stuff like that. So I would say within the Ivy Leagues, it's pretty safe to say that the course load is pretty similar. There's nothing too crazy. I do know that like Columbia has the core curriculum, which is pretty standard across all majors.
Yeah, I'm a really big fan of the distributional requirements because as an engineer, like I don't necessarily need to be taking an intro English class or other intro classes like that. Me as an engineer, I can go and take English 114, which is a writing seminar in super intelligence and AI, and get my writing credit that way. And it really allows you to kind of create your own Yale experience or Princeton experience.
And going off of that, I think as an AB major, as an economics major, someone who's not really interested in STEM, being forced to take a science class, even though it may not be my passion, there are still a bunch of different courses that you can take just even remotely related to your interest.
So a big concern with students when they're applying to Ivy League schools is the workload. They're not sure exactly how hard these classes are gonna be. I mean, they do have the Ivy League reputation. So it's something that a lot of people are curious about. And we'll share a little bit about how difficult our courses actually are at our respective schools.
So going into my freshman year, I know it can be a little intimidating. There's so many courses to choose from, you have no idea what you want to take, and acclimating to college is a completely separate thing as well. But when it comes to the workload, I found that freshman year honestly isn't that bad. They give you a lot of, not leniency, but time to figure out what you're doing before the courses start getting a lot harder. Your tests are later in the semester to give you time to, you know, get ready, get acclimated to the college environment, and I'm sure that's similar.
Yeah, so at least for me in high school, you have all your classes, you have them every single day, and you pretty much will have homework for all of those classes every single day. And it's just a lot of work and it's a lot of time spent in class. Whereas college, it's a lot different. You will not be in class for very long each week. Like I had classes 4 days a week and they averaged about 3 hours total each day, which comparing to like the 8 hours you spend in high school every day is like crazy.
On top of that, being in college itself just means you're gonna have to be a lot more independent. You're gonna have to manage your time better, figure out when you're gonna cram for a test, have a game plan to get ready for final season. That's regardless of whatever college you're at, because if you don't manage your time well, then the workload starts to pile on, which leads to more stress.
So for me, for every single one of my engineering classes, I would be assigned a problem set each week. These problem sets are normally really long and aren't something you can knock out in 2 hours. A lot of times they'll end up taking 8 to 10 hours. I know I spent probably 15 or 16 hours a week on my linear algebra problem sets this past semester, but what you do have at the schools like this is so many resources to help you.
I think we're very fortunate in the fact that Ivy League schools understand that the academia is incredibly difficult, but that doesn't mean that they won't provide resources to help you. So office hours, utilize that. You know, tutoring resources. I know that TAs and lab assistants, they have specific hours that are designated just to help students get through the problem sets. From an AB perspective, we have things like essays every few weeks or quizzes or tests. So regardless of whatever your major is, the workload is manageable as long as you manage your time well.
Ask questions. No, merci.
Good price.
No, merci. We just got asked if we wanted beer, wine, champagne.
You do?
Demonetized.
I've also found that in office hours, you'll develop a close group of friends from that class.
And study
you'll
be groups.
Able, yeah, study groups. And you'll all go to office hours together, help each other with the piece sets, and it just makes the class a lot easier.
If getting into the Ivy League is one of your top priorities, we highly recommend checking out our sponsor of today's video, Crimson Education.
If you've been watching either of our channels for a while, I guarantee you, you've been recommended at least one of Crimson Education's videos that are created to help students get into top-ranked colleges.
Their main goal is to help connect students with a team of experts, strategists, and tutors to best prepare yourself for the college application, whether it's essay brainstorming or SAT prep tutoring, or just having a game plan to tackle your college applications.
The best part is that it actually works, and Crimson has had over 460 offers to top 50 colleges just since 2015. And if you're an international student, don't worry, Crimson has over 25 offices across the globe.
If you've ever felt lost in the college application process or want to make yourself stand out amongst the thousands of other applicants that are going to be applying to these schools, definitely check out the link below, and Crimson will help you come up with a tailored plan that is affordable and customized to your needs.
A lot of our friends at Princeton and Yale have used college consulting services similar to Crimson, and they've only had good things to say, as it kind of creates a support system for you as you're preparing for college applications and studying in high school.
So make sure you check out the link down below, and they'll have plenty of options for you to choose from, and
you won't regret it.
So I think what's pretty unique to some of the Ivy League schools is that we have a big residential college system. Now at Princeton, it's a little bit smaller than Yale's. We only have 7 residential colleges where you eat most of your meals, your dorm is located there, you have like monthly activities hosted by your residential college, even trips to like New York or Broadway shows or anything like that. And the reason that we like residential colleges so much is that it's very similar to Harry Potter, Hogwarts, right? Like, there's a big sense of community and unity within your residential college, because sometimes you compete against other colleges or you like to brag about which dorm is nicer and things like that.
Definitely. The Yale residential college system is a little bigger. We actually have 14 residential colleges.
How many people per, you think?
There is about 400 people per college, which means that there's only about 100 people in your class at the college. And at least for me, I happen to be in a college that has a very like close-knit community. I know the names and will be able to walk into the dining hall and have a conversation with anyone in my class, and most of the upperclassmen too.
I think a big question we get asked is like, how is food at college? How are the dining halls? And to be honest, they're pretty good. I have no complaints, at least at Princeton. The chefs are really great. They do a really good job of providing you with the right nutrition and vitamins that you need to be healthy and stay fit. Because as great as the endless buffet is, you should still be taking care of your body, making sure that you're getting your vegetables, drinking your water, and yeah.
Definitely, yeah. So unlike a lot of big state schools that have like maybe 2 or 3 like big dining halls, Princeton and Yale both have dining halls in every single residential college, right? So Yale has 14 residential college dining halls, no central dining hall at all. So you will get a unique dining experience at each residential college. I think they have 2 menus that they'll flip-flop each night, so it will differ depending on what residential college you go to.
Do you guys have meal swipes, or is it like dining dollars or something?
We have meal swipes.
Okay, we have meal swipes too, which means basically you swipe and then it's just unlimited, which is awesome.
Yes, so you have a swipe for each meal, and then at Yale, if for some reason you are at class and you don't have time to grab lunch, we also have a little convenience store that's located right on Old Campus. You can go in there and get a bunch of different snacks, sandwiches, chicken tenders, or whatever you want with your meal swipe.
We have the same exact thing.
Like I said earlier, we really like to work hard.
But at the same time, we do like to play hard.
This means that not only are the academics top tier at these Ivy League schools,
but the parties are top tier
as well.
Speaking from Princeton's experience, we have something called the eating clubs. So an eating club is essentially your junior and senior year. You can either sign in or bicker in, which means like applying and rushing the process. But every Thursday and Saturday night, that's where all the events are held. We do have fraternities and sororities, but you're not allowed to rush into them freshman year at all. So all the parties are held at the eating clubs. Like I said, Thursday and Saturdays are the biggest nights. And the really great thing at most of the Ivy League schools compared to the state schools is that the parties are pretty much open to the entire campus. On some nights you might have to get a pass from an upperclassman, but it's not something like the state schools where if you're not in the fraternity, you can't get into the fraternity. I don't know if that's the case at Yale.
Yeah, so Greek life is definitely a lot bigger at Yale, but I would not say that it's dominating. I know at a lot of state schools, if you're not in a fraternity or a sorority, you have no social life. That is not the case at all at Yale. Anyone can get into a fraternity party for the most part. Some of them are listed or sometimes they have special parties, but for the most part, if you want to go to a fraternity on a Friday or Saturday night, you will be able to get in.
Aside from the parties and everything like that, social life at Princeton mainly consists of, besides studying, you know, just getting food with your friends. We have this thing called Nassau Street, which is right outside of campus. And you know, you go there for bubble tea or dinner or just to hang out with your friends. Another great thing is that Princeton is only an hour and a half away from New York City. So on the weekends, you and your friends can take the train up and just hang out in the city, which is really convenient. I do it all the time.
Yeah, same thing at Yale. We're 2 hours from New York City, so it's great to be close to the city. There's a lot of cool opportunities and events there. Like Nick was saying, a big part of social life is getting to know the people in your residential college, getting to know the people in your extracurriculars. I found at Yale that it kind of, the residential college system kind of forces you to have like these separate groups of friends. You'll have like, you'll have your residential college group of friends, you'll have your extracurricular groups of friends, you'll have your fraternity or sorority groups of friends. And it's kind of a really cool environment because you'll be able to go and eat at their residential colleges. And another big aspect is that each residential college also has its own party suites. Along with fraternities and sororities, we have party suites like the TD, my residential college, has an octet, which is a large party space that will have parties on the weekends. The legendary party suite at Yale is the Saybrook 12 pack. It's like multi-story, it's absolutely insane.
I need to come to Yale.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
All right, so next up we're gonna be talking about our individual campuses. They're similar in some aspects, but also very different. So Princeton is located in Princeton, New Jersey. It's more of a suburban town compared to Yale, which is more of downtown. Personally, I thought I was more of a city guy, but after like being in New York so much, I realized it's always not that great to be in a loud environment where, you know, it might not be as safe or anything like that. So being in the suburbs is a nice getaway from the loudness of downtowns. It's also very safe. I have no problem walking home from the library at 1 or 2 a.m. because campus itself is very centrally located. There's no huge gates or anything like that, but the campus itself is all located within one vicinity, which makes it really convenient. Weather-wise, I will say that coming from Dallas, I was not prepared for the cold. It is brutally cold in the east because winter, early January, February, the winds get brutal. When it snows and you're trying to get to class, that is the absolute worst. Yeah. Trying to do the rain and the snow with your textbooks, it's brutal. It's honestly like, ugh.
It's definitely cool to live in a different climate, but the winters are definitely long and cold. I mean, it is the Northeast. So Yale is located about, I'd say, 4 hours north of Princeton. It's in New Haven, Connecticut. It's a pretty decent sized city. It's about a mile or two from the beach, which is pretty cool. Yale really is downtown New Haven. New Haven kind of built up around Yale. So Yale is at the center of everything. Along with this, you are in the center of a pretty decent sized city, which means that I have to cross streets. Pretty much I will cross 5 or 6 different streets to get to different classes. That was something that I was a little worried about when I first visited Yale. I'm like, wow, everything's kind of like blocked into its own like city blocks. But after living there for a year, you learn how to jaywalk and you get really, really good at jaywalking.
Do you ever feel unsafe being in the city or anything like that?
No. Like, I know New Haven among the Ivy League kind of has a bad rap for not necessarily being like the safest city, but my experience has been great. The Yale security and Yale police are fantastic. Shout out to Chief Ronell Higgins. He updates us on everything that's going on around campus. There's blue lights. So I think you're like within 100 feet of a blue light wherever you are on campus. And then you can also call Yale security at any time of the night if you don't feel comfortable walking home or if you just have a big group of friends and want to go back to the residential college together. All right, that's about it for this video. If you guys enjoyed, feel free to drop a thumbs up down below. It helps me and supports the channel a lot more than you think. If you have any other questions on this topic, I would recommend commenting down below and I will try to answer them. Also, you guys only saw half the video. The other half of the video is actually on Nick's channel right now. He just posted it. I will leave the link in the description below. Go check out his channel, go subscribe. He is a phenomenal YouTuber, a great filmmaker, a great photographer, and he has a lot of great content that you guys can benefit from. If you're new, definitely subscribe because the content isn't stopping anytime soon. And with that, I will see you guys in the next video.